Hello and good afternoon. Good afternoon for us, at least. So welcome to Season 2, Episode 2. Right? Two. Am I correct? Season 2, Episode
yes.
2. All right.
Yes.
Season 2, Episode 2 of Tbreak's OneShot podcast. We're here. Tbreak usually provides tech, gaming, movies, TV, a whole bunch of news. But today, we are focusing completely on homes and home automation. I'm joined by my colleagues Sam and Abbas. Abbas Hello. Joins all the way from San Francisco.
That's right. It's like
what's the time there
right now?
Are you awake because you're dedicated to this podcast?
Yes, sure. That's it.
We also have Rami with us. Rami is the smartest guy as far as home automation is concerned. From what we know, he has a job on the side, we don't know. I guess that's to pay for all the automation. But Rami, thank you for being on.
Hi, Dinesh. Thank you.
Awesome. If this is your first time to the podcast, we are available on all platforms, including Podbean, Spotify, Apple, etc., etc. And as well as you can watch the podcast on our YouTube channel, which is tbreak.com. That's dot spelled D-O-T. Jumping right in, we were recently at IFA. All of us were there, Sam, me, Abbas, we were all there. Guys, we got to see some really fun stuff. I think that there was this whole section dedicated just to automated lawnmowers. And I was just like, damn, that's where we are now. Like, automated lawnmowers have a whole section.
Now, IFA was pretty amazing this year. I thought it was better this year as far as the products were concerned. Generally speaking, it can be a little boring, but this year I think they had some fantastic products to show, and we saw a lot this year.
We did. The first thing we saw, which was the first thing I saw as soon as I walked in, was the Ecovacs G1 lawnmower. And like, I was just looking at the specs on this thing and I was blown away. I was like, this thing can cover like massive yards, go uphill, downhill, can mow the lawn, can charge itself, can empty its container on its own. I was like, okay, like outdoor robotics is here, is absolutely here. Did you guys get to see it while you were there? Because we were separate at this point. Did you guys get to see it in real life?
No, I didn't get to see this particular one.
Fair. No. There was another one, which was a German company, I think. I forget the name. And obviously, it was in German, so definitely forget the name. But it was the same concept, but it had those old-style bags on the back of it. You know those old-style lawnmower bags?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, it had that on it, and you could put various sizes. But the fact that we've spent 3 minutes talking about lawnmowers and automated ones blows my mind. But then we also saw, and I mean, this is not exactly home automation, but I want to mention them. One, because, well, they took a bus to IFA, but also because, like, I think they have cool products, is the stuff we saw from Shark Ninja. I think that That's was right. really cool. Abbas, you got to see a bunch of them. Can you take us through a few of them?
I did, absolutely. So Shark Ninja is expected to sort of arrive in our region directly by the end of the year and over the course of next year, bring pretty much all of their products. Now, they are mostly focused on the, I'd say, kitchen/appliances/home sort of category. Mm-hmm. And they're neither super premium nor super cheap. So they've sort of positioned themselves in the middle of everything, and they do tons and tons of products, from vacuum cleaners to smart ovens to hair products to coffee makers, which was definitely my favorite bit on there. They had tons of things. There's a slushy maker, which obviously was the star of the show, that hasn't come to our region yet, but it's phenomenal. You literally just put juice or any liquid in it and it turns it into a slushy, no ice needed. So it's really awesome. We got to try every single product as well. So they actually made coffee for us, made slushies, made ice creams, made everything for us. And hey, I would love some of these products at my home. I think they're awesome.
Absolutely agreed. Actually, funny enough, the one product that always makes me think of Sam is their frost vault coolers. The first time I saw this product in real life, it's one of those regular coolers, right? and okay. it's got two sections. Okay. Mm-hmm. So it's got the regular lift the lid and you've got a section in there, but you've also got a little drawer on the bottom to put your meats and stuff like that. And then they say, oh yeah, this can keep things cool for up to 6 days. And I was like, 6 days, cool. So like it's powered. And they're like, no, this is our tech. What? And this can
it's
stay cool
powered.
For 6 days. It's not powered. I told them that I don't believe it. And they were like, the only way you will believe it is when like you get one of these. And it is so good. And it comes in like two sizes. So like every time I see that device, I'm like, oh, Sam's going to love one of these. Because it is like...
We need to get that.
Absolutely.
We need to test it out.
Absolutely in his wheelbarrow. But, but fair enough.
Yeah, what I liked about something they said, their CEO said, was that every time they pick a new product and it's ready to go, they actually send it to 1,000 homes and they keep it for a month or so to figure out what could be better. And they actually then go back and retool the product. So like most of the companies at this stage will release and then address it in the second version of the product. But they actually go and retool the product based on consumer feedback before they bring it to the market. So quite impressive. Very, very impressive stuff.
Wow. I think that's unheard of in this day and age. We're always the guinea pigs.
So funny enough, he told me something similar when I met him in Dubai when they did their first event here. And he told me something similar because I asked him, I was like, listen, I'm going to say something, don't mind. And he's like, what? And I was like, why are your products not the prettiest? And that's when he told me this as well, where he's like, for us, function is over everything. So it does not matter that it might not look the best or it might be an odd shape, because I was talking to him regarding the vacuum cleaners. And in the world of the Dysons and the Samsungs, it's not exactly the prettiest vacuum, but functionally, it is phenomenal. Like they've got one vacuum, which is this little, it's sort of dedicatedly, it has one function, which is that it's meant for when you spill coffee on a sofa or a carpet. So it has super suction, so it can pull liquid out, and that's its primary function. Of course, it can technically vacuum, but it's not meant for that. And it does the whole liquid cleaning thing. I thought it was phenomenal, phenomenal. So yeah, they do have really cool products.
They do. The other thing that I also asked them at IFA, and that was like, everybody's talking about AI and you guys aren't. And thankfully he said, yes, no, we're not talking about AI. There's no need for AI in our appliances right now. He said, we do offer automation in there. So obviously they've got, you know, you're programming your whole floor through for your vacuum cleaner and stuff like that. But he's like, as far as AI is concerned, no, not right now. I'm glad.
I mean, I'm glad too, because you just saw an AI printer. So let's
never in my wildest dreams imagine that you'd need AI in a printer. But hey, here we are. We have AI in a printer now. And you know what? I was actually surprised on the reasoning that they showed why you could need it, and it made sense because I've actually
For context, this is an HP printer at HP Imagine, which
That's correct. Yeah. So the reason I'm here in San Francisco is for the HP Imagine event, where they showcased quite a few new products. And one of them was a printer, their Envy series, which is a nice looking printer. I never thought I'd say that, but it is a nice looking and it comes with some AI chops. You know, when they first mentioned AI, I'm like, yeah, sure, whatever, you know, everybody's just using AI. But then they mentioned a couple of examples, which I was like, wait a minute, you know, I've been there, done that, like that's happened to me. And they mentioned that, for example, when you're printing out a spreadsheet, how many times have you had it where the last column gets printed on that last page where there's nothing else but that? So AI actually examines the sheet for you before it sends out to the printer and suggests different layouts for you and tells you, hey, this might be a better layout than the one that you have suggested, which I thought was fantastic. I thought that was a great use of AI. Same thing for when printing something off the web, a web page or something along those lines. How many times have we seen where you get the menus or the sidebars?
Right.
Worse, like you get ads printed on it, which have a dark background, which totally destroys your ink. So they actually say, you know, they showcase where it actually scans the whole documents, lays it out beautifully, and instead of taking 10 pages to print, prints it out in like 4 pages. So
nice.
Impressive stuff. Very impressive stuff.
That's pretty cool. For the people listening and watching, the reason Rami has a big smile on his face is because this was a plug he wanted, because Rami works at HP. But Rami, this one was specially for you. But coming back to home and home automations, The last thing I want to talk about from IFA, which I think was the one stand where all three of us were like super excited, was Akara. And Rami also is a big fan of Akara. So what we saw at IFA, the one that blew me away was the G5 camera. They had
a dark
room to show sort of the darkness in, let's say, a closet or a garage or something like that. And the camera shows a feed, which is not just lit, like not just like, what do you call that, Sam? The
night light thingy. Infrared?
The infrared. It's not just infrared, but it's like color. Like it knew what it was looking at and the color that's coming back to it. I thought that was absolutely amazing.
Yeah, totally.
I think now we
know where those camera sensors for the Huawei Mate 40 Pro ended up in, because the rest of the world didn't get to see them.
That is so true. But this water sensor that we saw, Bas, can you tell us a little about that?
Absolutely. So it's one of those sensors that doesn't require you to sort of, it's over the handle installation. You literally plug it in and it detects a water leak using one of their leak sensors. And if it does that, the camera sort of turned towards the leak and the lever automatically switches off. So it cuts off your water supply. Phenomenal. I think just fantastic. You know, it's great because many of us have been in at a time where you've had a water leak and that runs up your Diva bill or worse. So I think, you know, great stuff. Really, really good stuff.
So Rami, just before we hopped on to record, you were telling us a story about water leak. Can you tell that to the audience as well?
Yeah, so I once had to literally change the full ceiling at my flat because I had a water leak from the AC. The reason is being the condensation in the coil, and then it keeps dripping, and I had to change the full thing. So I have actually that Akara same leak detector there. So whenever it detects a leak, it switches off the AC immediately. So I don't get a chance to have a damage on my ceiling.
That's
one of the great uses for it.
No, definitely. But listen, as a sort of reminder, or if someone is listening to us for the first time, Rami has one of the smartest homes I have ever seen in my life. And I'm talking about like smarter than the smart home showrooms that we get to see in stores. He is an absolute expert in the matter. The easiest way I can tell you about how many automations he has is that one day he showed me his iPad and all the automations he has, and he was scrolling, and he still wasn't done. So I was shooting a little B-roll of his iPad, and I was just like, you know what, you can stop here. I don't need this much footage of the automations. But Rami, why don't you tell us some of the upgrades you've got since we last spoke?
Yeah, definitely, Dinesh. So I'm happy that you spoke about Akara. I'm happy that you visited their booth in IFA, because most of the upgrades that I've done are Akara, from the Akara brand. And shout out to that company, to be honest. So I've got myself the new Akara U100 lock, which literally allows you to use Apple Passkey, which is something new. So it's similar to Apple Wallet. You can just tap your phone on the lock and it will automatically unlock. And it has many different ways. Of course, it has fingerprint, code, app control, even physical lock is available, which was not available in my previous lock, the Yale Assure Lock 2. Okay. I also included a display unit from Akara, which allows me to control multiple scenes and three physical switches. So I'll get three physical switches and six different scenes that I can control. I've installed two of them, one in the kitchen and one in the bedroom, where I have some things like good morning, good night, get ready for bed, etc. On top of that, I have switched from the Akara D1 light switches to the Akara E1 light switches. That is a really unnecessary switch. It's just because of the color. So they released the gray color, and I was so happy that they had this color, and I wanted it forever now.
To be fair, it sounded unnecessary before you said it, so it's okay. It's all right.
No, I'm just saying that I didn't face any issue with the D1 switches. It's just that I wanted the colored option.
So I'm curious to know, I've got the H1 switches. What's the difference between the D1 and the E1 and the H1? Any idea?
Design mostly. And I think the H1 are the ones that are with neutral. So they do not come without neutral. So the E1 comes without neutral and it only comes in two colors. The H1 also includes this type of lighting and an assistant included in that switch. That's why it requires neutral. Unfortunately, in Dubai.
For people who might not know, can you explain what neutral is?
Okay, so in houses, usually there are three types of wires. You have the live, you have the ground, and you have the neutral. Neutral comes usually either at the bulb side or at the switch side. Now, when you read about it, if you put it at the bulb side, it's easier, it's cheaper, it doesn't require that much work. And that's why they put it all at the bulb side, most of them. Mostly in US, houses that are built in the late 1960s, I would say, they have neutral at the switch side. That's why companies started focusing on adding neutral to the switch. However, in the UAE, so far, most of the houses that I've been to and I've installed the smart homes at, friends and family, of course, they do not have neutral at the switch. So I advise anyone who wants to buy a light switch to go with a non-neutral option. Or they have there are switches that have neutral as an optional in the switch, which you could either plug it or not, and that's the safest option. But mostly they come without neutral connection.
One of the advantages if you have a neutral in your home is that these neutral switches from Akara at least extend the Zigbee network, so more coverage. So if you have a neutral and you extend the switch, it sort of extends like it's as it keeps it as like amplifies your Zigbee signal to further down. So if you have more switches, it's like a repeater of a Wi-Fi. Think of it something like that.
Okay.
So if you have neutral, that comes in handy with that. If you don't have neutral, then obviously that functionality doesn't exist.
But also, Abbas, to your point, the display from Akara, S1E, it's called S1E, Akara Display S1E, it requires neutral. So the way that I worked around it is I installed it instead of a heater switch. Because heater, washing machine, and gas switches are supposed to have neutral. So that's what I did. I replaced the heater switch with those panels.
So how do you put on the heater when you have to?
Because it's got a
physical switch. There are three physical switches.
Oh.
Physical, so it's all a has... switch, but physical. You need to connect it physically.
Yeah, exactly. See, Rami, we're supposed to be making this easier for people, not more difficult.
but that's a cool hack to know, right?
It is a fantastic hack. It is a fantastic hack. But tell me something. The last time you were here, you mentioned, or rather actually both Abbas and you agreed on the fact that matter was not where it was supposed to be. In the last little few months that we've had this conversation, have things changed? Maybe Abbas, you can go first, and then Rami, or vice versa. You guys decide.
Look, I think matter matures by the week. Every week, there's something happening with there. There are still some devices that are not matter compliant, and I think cameras are one of them. I'm not 100% sure. Some of the devices are still not matter compliant, but we've seen matter upgrade to, what is it, at 1.2 right now? I'm not quite sure, 1.1 or 1.2. And it keeps getting better as far as stability is concerned, reliability is concerned. And I'm still on Zigbee. I still haven't switched completely to matter, which Zigbee is an older standard, which I think for me works better right now. But the future is matter, definitely. And I'm sure
Abbas, thoughts. If I could ask you, do you prefer Zigbee not just because it is more mature as a
because platform? It's more reliable.
Okay. Fine. Rami, matter?
I have the same views as Abbas. I've seen significant change to matter, and it is evolving very quickly. I'm testing few matter devices at home, and they're working perfectly. I think some of the issues, for example, one of my LED strip lights, it does not have adaptive lighting when you connect it through Matter. But if you connect it through Wi-Fi or any other HomeKit, let's say, code, it does have the adaptive lighting. But that's a problem on Apple's side. It's not on the manufacturer's side. So the assistants and the platforms need to adapt as fast as Matter is progressing. Now, I also prefer to stay at Zigbee. For one main reason is because when you connect with Matter, you're connecting the device to Wi-Fi directly. However, if you're connecting to Zigbee, you're connecting multiple devices to one hub, and that hub is connected to Wi-Fi. So that reduces the amount of appliances that are connected to your Wi-Fi. So not many devices will be connected to Wi-Fi, which will not strain your Wi-Fi router, right? So you don't need to really upgrade your Wi-Fi. That's why I'm also hung at Zigbee, and because I've invested already so much on Zigbee, I'm not allowed to invest anymore in Matter. I advise anyone who wants to buy a new device, I would say, or who has, let's say, a simple smart home or an advanced smart home, whichever new device that you want to introduce, if it's available in Matter, get the Matter version, because that's where the future is, and you would not need to upgrade in the near future, let's say.
Okay. It's future proof.
Yes.
Yeah. Listen, I go ahead about
that. I was just going to add a little bit to Rami's comments, that Rami mentioned that it's on a Wi-Fi network, but just to sort of clarify a little bit, it runs on an IP6 Wi-Fi network, not your IP4 network, which is probably what you're using to connect your iPhones and MacBooks and stuff like that. Yes, it is using your Wi-Fi network, but it's not necessarily part of your main Wi-Fi network. It creates an IP6 based network, a thread network that it sort of connects over.
Fair. So in this scenario, when people are sort of getting... Okay, so first and foremost, we've got the fact that people should ideally invest in Matter right now. That's sort of a confirmed deal.
Yeah.
Right? Is this business with Matter, is it affecting the choice of Amazon versus HomeKit versus Google?
No, Matter is compatible across all of these ecosystems. So that was one of the biggest advantages of Matter, that Apple supports it, Google supports it, Amazon supports it. That is one of the advantages of it.
So imagine that I have enough to start off a home with. Okay, just imagine basic accessories and stuff like that. In the current space of smart homes, have any changes occurred to these respective platforms which are making things easier? Like, for example, let's say about a year ago when I was most up to date with smart homes, Google seemed to be the easy way to go, right? It seemed like the more accessible one. The question I'm asking is, has the fact that Matter is now involved, has it made any of these paths easier? Like, for example, with Apple Intelligence on the horizon, I'm a little excited that maybe HomeKit's going to get better and smarter, right? So that's kind of my question, that has anything changed in this regard?
No, I don't think, as far as ease of use is concerned, if that's what you're asking, I don't think there's been much progress on that. I'll give you an example. I recently added a smart plug, which was a Matter-based plug, and I was adding it to Home Assistant. And the first question it asked me when I was trying to add it to was that, have you already connected this to another hub or not? So, you know, there's a little bit of friction there. It makes you think like, wait a minute, you know, is it already connected to my network? Or what do I need to set on there? And taking that same example of that smart plug, using Home Assistant, I could only add it using the Home Assistant mobile app, not the web interface, because obviously it required me to scan using a camera and stuff like that. So there is a bit of friction. That friction still exists. Maybe the Apple Home app will remove that, and it does. It does remove that to a significant degree. But then the automations that are offered in the Apple Home app aren't as powerful as you'd get in something like Home Assistant. So it's still a very evolving space. I won't necessarily say that it's easier to use. I think what they're focusing on right now is the compatibility issue, to sort of make sure that the device works across all ecosystems. I think that's more focused right now. And then once all of that is completely set, that's probably when they'll, you know, work towards ease of use or, you know, whatever else it is.
Rami?
I think I'm on the same page with Abbas. It doesn't add anything to ease of use. I think it adds less hassle to the, for example, to the person who's installing the smart home, because you can start running automations. If you have Matter devices, you can start running automations regardless of which assistant you are using. If you have, I gave you that example last time. If you have an iPhone and your wife has an Android, it is very difficult to set automations when she leaves, when you leave, etc. It's difficult to put it all in one ecosystem. But with Matter, you can add both products here and there and then set automations on the Google Home, one set automation on HomeKit. We set the same automations and that's it. That's all you need. So I don't think it adds anything to the ease of use apart from the compatibility, solving the compatibility issues as Buzz was saying.
Yeah, because that's where I tend to lose the attention of people who ask me about smart homes. That's where I have this kind of running joke in my head that like I have three sentences. If in three sentences I can't convince them, it's gone, because there are so many ifs and buts in this conversation. Like I sent the Akara U100 to a friend of mine, and like he wanted to start building a smart home, blah, blah. I sent it to him, I think a year ago, and he still hasn't bought it because like, you know, it's such a fast evolving space and people find it really difficult to catch up when they understand that, okay, there's a lot of effort required on their side. Whereas, and obviously platform to platform is different. So for example, Miros, when I install their smart switches, it's all manual, like down in the dirt manual. You have to set it up. And like you said, Abbas, you have to have a camera to set it up on HomeKit and all that stuff. Whereas with Philips Hue, as soon as you set it up, it like asks you, do you want this automation? Do you want that automation? Do you want the light this way? Do you want the light that way? I think that lack of universality, excuse me if that's the correct word, but yeah, that is the part that sort of just throws people off the smart home track. Because I'm not saying that everyone has to have a Rami house or an Abbas house, but like just the smallest things people just avoid because of the amount of manual work required. That's why I asked that previous question.
No, totally. And I'll give you another example where it also, you know, stops people from using it. Now, I've had Philips Hue lights at my house for a good 7 years, and they have been super reliable. But literally last week during sunset, they didn't come on. You know, none of them came on, even though the hub was on, the network was on, everything was on. And, you know, we were out and we walked back into the home and we're like, why is it so dark over here? We were just wondering. And, you know, I just realized that none of the Hue lights went on, even though I haven't had an issue with them over the last 4 years, 5 years. But there is still that occasional hiccup that happens. You know, it's just my wife was like, okay, what happens if you're not here when this happens, you know, if you're traveling or something, like, how do I do this? Because I'm pretty told, do not touch any light switch whatsoever. So,
literally for that exact reason, I have 3 manual lamps in the house. For that exact same question from my wife, I have 3 manual lamps. I'm like, if I'm not here, live with these lamps till I come back.
That's also why I always advise, if you're going to change the lighting to smart lighting, change the switch, do not change the bulb. Bulb is very difficult to go. Sometimes I'm at home and I literally just go to the switch to press it. Although I have, if I say the words, the house will turn on. But it's just that I don't want to do it. I just want to go to the switch. I want to go physical. Sometimes I have my grandmother visiting and... She will not. She will think that there are demons in the house if I show her how to speak to those assistants, right? So you need it to be a little bit in between. Rather than changing the bulbs, go for the switches, because they're actually physical switches.
No, I completely agree. And that's after our last podcast discussion, that's the route I'm sort of going to. Wherever I have more than 3 light bulbs that are smart, I'm trying to change that to a switch.
Right. Yeah. Same. I literally have to do that ASAP because my mother-in-law is coming down soon. And her room is the most automated room in the house. Like that's my wife's room, and it's got like the nice lights and the switches and the speakers and this and that. And I was like, oh my God, I need like an iPad or like a switch here, something to make it all manual ASAP. That I think is the biggest reason that people just aren't jumping on this. But Sam, you have been extremely silent in the home automation conversation.
I'm just absorbing this wealth of information from all of you. You know,
where anything you have coming up that you're sort of looking to do as far as home automation is concerned?
I think kind of leading on to what you were saying earlier, I think there's a lot of, I look at myself and I look at, you know, friends that have sort of dabbled with the whole, I wouldn't say home automation, but smart homes. So you buy your device that you can talk to. That's usually the first step. You're picking whichever platform, as Rami mentioned. But then you get a couple of light bulbs. It's kind of cool. Your friends come over. Oh, I can do the RGB and this and all of that. But I don't think it gets you. The critical thing, maybe for a follow-up episode, is delving into the automation element to it. Like, I'm using it in the most probably dumbest form. So, for example, I say, so-and-so, turn on the lights. My wife will mess with the brightness level. And then, as Rami mentioned, it's like you've got to go into the app, the specific app of the bulb, to then get the white back to what it was, or the brightness, because between assistants, it gets confused. So I think kind of going into the automation thing of like, okay, if this is the scenario, for example, I woke up in the middle of the night, I need to go to the loo. Rami's got something there to say, okay, if it's this scenario and then that scenario, then do that. That is home automation.
Like, listen, man, for people who might not have heard this before, Rami, poor thing, showed me his whole house, showed me all the automation, showed me everything. The part that I lost my mind, which I was like, you know, one of those things that you were like, as an adult human being, have I not thought of this myself? And Rami's like, yeah, so in the night, between something like 11 p.m. to 5 a.m., if I wake up and I go to the washroom, the light only turns on like, what was it, Rami, 5%, 2%? And I was like, this is genius.
Yeah,
this is genius. But now, Sam, we don't actually have to wait for another episode. I mean, this is our home automation episode. But Rami, why don't you tell us in the sense that which are, like, listen, there's obviously a lot of stuff you do for fun, right? To see where the technology is and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But which are your, like, can you give us like maybe two or three of your like top automations?
So I would definitely go back to what Sam was mentioning. So, and this is, by the way, just let me start with something else. Automations are something that evolve over time. So you live in that automation. And if it doesn't work for you, you need to change it. There's no one that will come and tell you this automation will work. I can give you suggestions. Yeah. Even HomeKit gives you suggestions. Like when you set up the light, it will tell you suggested scenes. Do you want to add it to goodnight? Do you want to add it to leave home? Those are suggestions. At the end of the day, you select this. So for example, my bathroom in the bedroom, it has LED lights and it has two lights. And I have two scenes. One is get ready for bed and one is good night. If get ready for bed is on, the big light, let's say, will not turn on in the bathroom once you walk in. But if good night is on, the LEDs will only turn at 1%. So you don't get hit with those lights when you enter the bathroom if you wake up in the middle of the night, for example.
Right.
So those are the types of automations that you will feel that, okay, maybe I need this, I need to switch that. I started last time when we met, it was at 50%. And then I realized, okay, 50% is too much. Now it's at 1%. So I barely need any light when I wake up, right?
Right.
So that's why, I mean, it keeps evolving, it keeps changing. You need to keep working on it. I will never get, say, this is the amount of automations that I need. I don't need anything else. No, I still keep working on them every day.
But asking all of y'all, in case y'all know, because this suddenly just came to me, is there some sort of like website or forum where people like put up their automations and stuff like that, where you can get this from? Because see, what I always say this, you always think of these things for the dumbest person in the room. And I don't mean dumbest as in not smart, but dumbest as in just lacks the interest. Like in a room talking about gaming, I'm the dumbest person. Like you could be showing me like 8K, 1000 FPS graphics and I'm just like, let's move on, right? It just doesn't appeal to me. So in that case, like, are there places where you can get the automations? Because I think you can download automations, at least on HomeKit, I think you can, right?
Yeah,
I think, again, depends on the platform that you're on. Like, for example, Home Assistant has its own website and community and forums where they share tons of automations. Same thing happens for Acara users on Reddit. I'm sure that, you know, they have ideas that they'd like to share. So I'd say Reddit is a good place for home automation. But then again, websites such as Home Assistant's website also offer tons of these.
So just to clarify, Abbas, when you say Home Assistant, you're talking about Home Assistant, the other platform, not HomeKit.
Well, okay. So it basically integrates. Home Assistant is it's not a standard by itself. What it does is it integrates all your Zigbees, all your threads, all your RF devices, and then allows you to cross-communicate between them just in case, let's say, that your preferred network provider or your preferred smart home automation doesn't talk to something else that's not its own kind. So it lets you connect different kinds of devices and automation.
Would this count as your Tesla automation, which you showed us?
Yeah. Absolutely, yes.
Could you just take us through that?
Sure, absolutely. So the way I've set it up is that I've got my Tesla connected to my Home Assistant, and my gate and my remote are also connected to Home Assistant. Now, they're on completely different platforms. I've got a contact sensor, an Acara contact sensor on the gate, which sort of recognizes if the gate is open or it's closed. And then I've got RF, radio frequency remote, that turns the gate on or off. And then I've got my car, Tesla, which is connected to Home Assistant. So what I've done is I've created an automation that, you know, if I turn the reverse gear on my Tesla and the gate is closed, which is where the Acara contact sensor comes in, then fire off the RF command from the remote to open the gate. So as soon as I get in, I press reverse on my car, the gate just starts opening by itself. This wouldn't be possible if I was using the Acara app or the Homes app or whatever else. This is where Home Assistant comes in, where it joins different pieces of technology to create a... Look, at the end of the day, the automation is literally an if-then statement. It's just that the amounts of ifs and the amounts of thens, basically, you know, if this, then, and, or if, and if, and if, and if, that's where things become super complicated. And, you know, that's what Rami was saying, where it's very much a scenario where you learn and then you keep adding to it. You literally start with, if this happens, then do that. And then you realize, wait a minute, if this happens and the time is between this and this, then do this. And then you realize that, wait a minute, I also want to check if, I don't know, the audio levels on something. So it becomes so complicated over time, but it grows with you. You start with something simple, and then you adapt it based on your needs.
Fair. Rami, any websites or forums or anything you know of? Anything that you have referenced in your learning days?
No, I'm just now on Tesla's website seeing how much it costs, because that just got me too excited, and now it just cost me 250,000 dirhams. It's going to be the most expensive smart device I've ever bought.
Yeah, to be fair, Abbas and Sam know this, I'm not a big fan of Tesla. I don't care for it. But that... one thing, that one fact that you can do such things with the Tesla, like when Abbas showed it to us a little while ago, I was like, oh dear, oh no. And I had like an aunt selling her Tesla, and I was like, oh no, oh, just for automations to buy a car. I can't understand this, but
there are ways to do the same with other cars. Unfortunately, greedy companies started wanting to monetize this, and they stopped making the APIs free. So in the past, with my car, I was able to do, when I say good morning, it waits after good morning for a certain amount of time and checks the date. If I have any calendar invites that are in the office, it starts the car 10 minutes before I
have
to
leave. On a different level.
Yeah, Fortunately, they have changed, and I don't want to mention the name, but they have changed their API.
Mention it. They made it. You don't make any money from the automotive industry. Mention it.
So I think the one I'm facing a problem with is Mercedes, and they've changed their API and they made it paid. And I think all of the other companies will follow. I'm not just saying them. I think everyone will follow that path. And it's really unfortunate, because it was giving me a lot, and I could have I could do something that means, because when the car switches on to using the remote, it only goes on for 10 minutes and then switches off automatically, right? So you could say when the car switches off, when the automatic remote when the remote starts, switches off, open the gate if it's closed. So it's as simple as this, because if you open the car as well, it it switches off. The remote starts switches off. So it's as simple as this. And I can just think of many uses for the automation that Abbas wanted to have or is having with his car.
Khalas, I have a Suzuki Jimny. We can break that thing open. Just find out what automations we can do. We can break that thing. It's a Lego block. I hit it just the other day and a part of the dashboard cracked. So we're all good, guys. Just find out what system we need. We can put it all in Sam's here with his automotive knowledge. We will cram that thing in with automations.
Yeah, with car factories running at half their capacity right now, they need to figure out ways to make money from the existing customer.
They really do. They really do.
Yeah.
But fair, but fair. I personally have nothing else left that I wanted to kind of ask you guys. I think that there's still a lot of self-involvement left. There's a lot of self-involvement in the smart home category right now. I was hoping that y'all would have said no, but it is what it is. I think that we will get there. I'm hoping that maybe by the next time we speak, the answer to the question, have the brands made it easier, changes a bit more, because I think that that's where smart homes are losing out right now. But yeah, final comments, gentlemen.
Look, from my side, I think what makes me super excited about smart home or automation in general is that we're finally getting large language models onto voice assistants, which I think are super dumb right now, whether it's Alexa, whether it's Siri, whether it's Google. And I think the fact that you're going to bring that to all these voice assistants, I think that's going to be a game changer, because there have been so many times where I can repeatedly hear my wife saying, "Siri, shut off the AC. Siri, turn off the AC. Siri, switch off the AC." And she just refuses to listen. So hopefully that will change. And we'll have more peace and harmony in smart homes.
Sam, anything you're excited for or disappointed by?
I think there's a huge potential for the AI element to come into home automation to make all of those scenarios that much easier. You know, if you had an assistant to say, "Oh, I've got so-and-so, I've got a switch, I've got this, like, give me some ideas of like, what can I use it for?"
Right.
And assist in setting it up, then like, wow, so that'll be really
cool. I think that ChatGPT is a very good example of that. Because ChatGPT had all its potential until ChatGPT 4. But 4.0 brought that contextual understanding where you could just say something to it, stutter, make a mistake, change your words, and it would bring it all forward to you. Because until ChatGPT 4, you had to learn prompting. You had to learn something. Whereas 4.0 brought about my verbal skills to give me access to that. And I think that that's where smart homes need to reach, where you buy X device and you say, "Hey, X, I want this to do this and this." Or even if, like you guys said, even if it's updating it, be like, "Oh, you know what? That automation that I have, I needed to do this and this." I think that that's where it all sort of needs to end up.
Yeah.
Rami?
True.
Final thoughts?
I mean, I would say try, test. Buy the product, buy one switch, try it before you get involved in everything. Follow content creators, follow tbreak.com. That's a very good advice. And go to Reddit. Of course, there are multiple threads about shortcuts. Back to your question, shortcuts. You can download these shortcuts. You can download these automations. You can get ideas. Most of the ideas that I get are not coming to my mind. It's something that I've read or I've seen on the web with content creators, etc. I think that's the best way to get invested in it, because that's the only way you will keep going and get excited when you start seeing that, "Oh, I can control more and more elements." Recently, I just forced my sister and her husband to change their house into a smart home. I literally just went online and bought them the products and had them pay me back. So that's how we should do it.
Until you said had them pay me back, I was be like, bro, I'm your brother. I'm also your brother.
No.
Banking should be also.
Now I'll tell you I'm your brother.
But fair. Gentlemen, thank you very much. This has been a lovely conversation. Shout out to producer Amara on the back end for sorting all this out. This is the Tbreak One Shot Podcast. If you enjoyed this conversation, have anything that you want us to look into, please do let us know in comments, on Threads, Insta, wherever you are. But until then, my name is Danish. These are my colleagues. And thank you very much for listening or watching.